speaker for today, is that we do, well not we are, we are Change Leeds, we also are kind of We Are Change Manchester. So what we've got to free today is a gentleman who's basically one of the founding members of the 9/11 Truth Movement within London and then in the UK. But his background and credentials is that he's worked for 11 years at the University College in London. And when July 7 happened, it became, obviously having woken up to 9/11, it became engrossed into researching, studying what's going on there. And he's become one of the prime researchers of the July 7 bombings. And at the moment, quite recently actually, the third edition of his book, Terror on the Tube, has come out, which includes, we think it was published early on this year.
Yeah.
So it includes details of what's come out of the recent hearings and stuff. So I recommend you get yourself a copy of that. I did have one, but I gave it away before I even read it. So I'll have to get the book from him. But so yeah, so kind of a good warm welcome to the Kollerstrom.
Well, it's a wonderful privilege to be here in Leeds, which is so important for this seminal event, for this new millennium. Brought so much sorrow and ruin into our culture, and increased militarisation, that was its purpose. Let's feel a moment of kind of almost grief that there aren't Muslims joining with us in this group. That's always the trouble. We're going to hear a story about Muslims, how Muslims being unfairly victimised, and we all know why they're victimised. It's because we want to keep bombing and invading their countries for raw materials and oil and so on. That is the dire reality, and we're here because we want to change that situation, okay? We're not happy about such a situation, which Britain's always going to war, and this kind of fabricated terror. It's the terrible reality that most people in this country still cannot face, that we have fabricated terror, state-sponsored. It takes quite a bit to accept that. And maybe it's people who are psychologically outsiders who are more prone to accept it. I don't know if you want to ask yourself, do you think, do you accept the thesis? And if so, are you a bit of an outsider? I sometimes say to people, if you've got any Irish friends, it's a good thing to talk to them about it, because your English friends would say, oh, they couldn't possibly do that. But your Irish friends would say, oh, yes, they could. And they would. And they do.
Yeah.
Liam Fox, the defence minister recently dismissed, said a few years ago, Israel's enemies are our enemies. And this is a battle in which we all stand together, which we all fall divided. Now, I'd like to recommend the view that we don't actually need any enemies, okay? Let's try to imagine living without enemies, okay? I'm especially not identifying with the enemies of Israel. I'm totally paranoid and psychotic state. The idea that you'd want to align yourself with Israel, well, that is historically what Britain has done, obviously, and especially it's what you expect from the Conservative Party. And Cameron has pledged unswerving allegiance to Israel, which I don't think he's ever done to this country. We are getting events which look suspiciously like Israel is somehow behind them, like the recent Norwegian tragedy. With false flag terror, there's almost some sort of Mossad fingerprint or some sort of Mossad trace of it. You're not quite sure how far it goes, okay? With the 7/7 story in London, you've got some indications of it. You've got Netanyahu, who was here in London on the morning, and he got an advance warning, 6 minutes in advance. And an ex-Mossad chief spoke out and said, yeah, we told him 6 minutes in advance. So they knew in advance that it was going to happen, just as they did on 9/11. 9/11, you get all sorts of evidence of Israeli foreknowledge. I won't go into details there, the Mossad appear the one intelligence agency that really knows exactly when it's going to happen. Everyone else knows it's going to happen, that something big is going to happen. But, for example, Zim, which is an enormous Zim shipping company that moved out of the Twin Towers, Israeli company, 1 week before, and they paid a fine for breaking a rent contract. And then the Adigo text messaging firm, which has a basis in Israel, got a message that morning that something had been at the exact time. And they warned people not to go in. So we do tend to have Israeli hints. And with 7/7, there was an article in the Jerusalem Post at 2 o'clock that afternoon, all about 7/7, and knowing far too much about it, and deeply ruminating. It was entitled "Rules for Conducting World War III," and there's obviously somebody who ruminated deeply about it for some time, and it actually said yesterday's bombings, synchronous bombings in London, very efficiently carried out. So it was as if it was meant to be posted the next day. So it's called yesterday's bombings, but by a chap called Halevi, Ephraim Halevi, a former head of Mossad. So we do have slight indications of Israeli foreknowledge. But the intelligence agencies of Britain, America and Israel are so closely connected that you can't exactly tell who has done what. All you can say is there's some corrupt elements there, and these things are being perpetrated. Israel has quite a history of fabricating these terror events. And in America, maybe it starts with the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center, which an Arab is framed, and then in 1996, the Oklahoma event, which was attempted to blame on Muslims, on Iraqis, and that didn't work. I'd like to suggest to you that there was a decade in the 1990s when the commie menace had vanished, and the world didn't have an enemy, and the whole Islamic jihad al-Qaeda image was being hatched and formulated, and that really hit the world got hit by that in 2001, when we were all told, without any more ado, without any doubt at all, that Muslims had done it. Okay, so that was the new enemy image that we were given. Not within 48 hours, 19 hijackers were put up, allegedly done it. Soon turned out that 8 of them were still alive. That was a really simple matter. And that's sort of been going on ever since, with horrific intensity. The same afternoon of July the 7th, Tony Blair rushed back from Scotland at the GX summit meeting, bus 5, and he told the British people, those who did this did so in the name of Islam. So we know this. How do we know that? You know? So he was instructing the police who to look for. And he then talked about the war on terror, which, if you think about it, is a very absurd concept. You can't have a war on terror. Okay? Terror is a psychological condition, and what they're doing is what creates the terror. The police were asked, given instructions of having a war on terror, and the honoured special branch of Scotland Yard, which were within just the right people to track down who had done this frightful crime in London. What happens then? Oh, they morph into counter-terror command. Counter-terror command, what's that? By 2006, the 100-century-old special branch in London morphs into counter-terror command. And counter-terror means, what does it mean? It means the police are told, look out for Muslims. They're given a directive who to look for, and British Muslims find themselves getting terrorised and victimised. I hardly feel safe on the streets. I think this is probably the case in Leeds today, that they're continually getting checked and inspected and intimidated by police. So this situation is just ongoing. One bright ray of hope on the horizon came a few months ago when a British called a principal intelligence analyst of Yorkshire Police, okay, this is important. Tony Farrell, South Yorkshire Police, and there are 43 principal intelligence analysts throughout the land, and he's one of them. And a bit over a year ago, he was asked to give his yearly report on what's called the threat assessment matrix, which means where the police look for the threat and the danger and everything. And it dawned on him that the whole thing, the 9/11 story was fabricated, okay? He went and talked to his chaplain, about this. I'm very shaken up that suddenly realised this thing was a manufacturer. And the chaplain told him, well, why don't you look at 7-7 as well? Which is a remarkable thing with chaplains in 7. So it did. And so this thing very mysteriously synchronised with July the 7th. 2010, July the 7th, he had a report to give in to his superior, and he basically told him, look, the chief terror threat is coming from the government. The government fabricated this event. It's not coming from West Coast. And so I can't quite do the report as you've asked me to. The police then took the view, I'm sure you heard the story, sorry, we've got to sack you. So a man is sacked for his beliefs, had an impeccable record, about 15 years working for the police, totally adequate service, and they just sacked him because he said about where he thought the terror threat was coming from. Perhaps we could discuss this afterwards, your opinions. Do you think that Yorkshire Police could function with a threat assessment matrix which says this? I mean, I do personally. I think they could just not do anything about that implication of crime at the top, but it would tell them they wouldn't have to harass Muslims all the time. They wouldn't have to go around checking up continually, trying to find terror where it doesn't exist. I think terrorists hardly exist in this country in the way we've been given to understand it.
It doesn't, or else there'd be bombs going up all over the place.
Sorry?
It doesn't, or else there'd be bombs going up all over the place.
Right.
You see a lot more of it.
Yeah. My impression is that Muslims are basically fairly mild, peaceable folk. And they get very, they're being very intimidated. And they don't know quite what to do. We always find this in the meetings when we try to talk about it. I would give anything to go and talk to one or two of the Muslims in the families around here, you know. It's so valuable if you cross that bridge, like an invisible glass plate. But all the people most important to talk to in the story, sometimes story, are Muslims who won't actually be about. If I mention who I think very few people are, there's Farida Patel and Hasina Patel. Now I want to especially honour this 30-year-old Mohammed Sidique Khan, who wasn't just anybody. They didn't just pick on anybody to do this thing, to be framed, fabricated, and character assassinated. He was a very special young man and a very special family. Hasina Patel's wife and Farida, her mother. Okay? Now let's try to put together what Farida did for the local community. She wanted some sort of spiritual council of churches, and the police would come to her for advice and guidance whenever any crime to do with race tensions and so on. They would consult her. She was one of the first people to be invited to Buckingham Palace, a party with the Queen. I think her and her husband, and possibly also her daughter, Zim Patel, all went to Buckingham Palace. As the newspaper put it, rub shoulders with the Queen. Mohammed Khan went to the House of Commons. He was invited by Hilary Benn, that's the son of Tony Benn. So this was a family that would certainly have been in local politics, so it's still been alive. There would certainly be a best known meeting in Dewsbury, and there wouldn't be a respected family, and some Muslims could look up to them, saying the local Muslim family that has really achieved something, and that might, in some degree, be why they were picked on. Of the four lads, four young men accused, certainly two of them looked up to him. Hasib Hussain and Tanwir, Shehzad Tanwir, they were to look up to him as kind of the boss, who kind of arranged and organised things and had ideas what to do. I think he was a bit older than the other two. Let's just recall some things he did in his life. He was a school mentor at a local primary school, Hillside Primary School, and his the headmistress, I'll just read out what the headmistress said about him. Mistress Sarah Balfour, on a bus of being nice to talk to him. He was great with the children and they all loved him. He did so much to help for them, helping and supporting them and running extra clubs and activities, so he was a real asset to the school and always showed an amazing commitment. He was especially proud of his skills in non-violent conflict resolution. I want you to get a picture of someone who was, though he was Muslim, he was very anglicised, proud of being English. He didn't wear his special English clothes all the time. He wasn't particularly religious. Sometimes got that sort of Friday feeling, saying, well, time to go to the mosque. But on the whole, he wasn't a very religious character. Although his wife took him along to the pilgrimage to Mecca. But he was quite anglicised. He went to America for a holiday and he came back loving America. He kept loving America. Wore American hat, American boots and stuff. And friends teased him for it. He was proud of doing stuff to help Leeds with some business enterprises he got into. When the Times Educational Supplement came to Hillside Primary School, there were only two people it interviewed. One was the headmistress, Sarah Balfour, and the other was Mohammed Khan, about the way in which the school was run. So he was a learning mentor. In 2001, they got married. So they lived in Dewsbury, like all of the lads, that they would go down to visit Pakistan. When Sinatra was asked in the only interview she's ever given, well, why did he go there? Because the media trying to make out how he was going to these terror training camps, you know, that's what they were trying to make out, you know, jihad camps in Pakistan. She said, oh, well, he went to visit his family. And the last year, in November 2004, when that was a very poignant moment, when he resigned from the school he was at, gave his notice, and left his wife pregnant with her second child. Now, I don't know if any of you remember the Kingston trial in 2008, but the trial make out that it's a heartless decision of a calculating killer to go off, leave his wife forever, and go off to a terror training camp. For behind jihad stuff in Pakistan. They had his letter of resignation to his headmistress, saying why he's leaving the school, and he had a sentence deleted for no reason. So I'm sorry, this is have to be the end of that, I'm leaving. So we were given this picture of the heartless way he went off and had to leave everybody. And then, rather absentmindedly, at the inquest, the truth came out that somebody read out the rest of the letter of resignation to his schoolmistress, and it said, came out, the reason he was going was because his father was terminally ill out there, so he had a moral, ethical decision, be with his wife, young wife, or his job at school, or to go to Pakistan and attend to his father who was dying. So I think that's quite a moving decision, and I'll just read what came out of the inquest 2011. Headmistress basically a letter from Mr. Khan stating that due to the fact that his father was ill, he needed to return to Pakistan, he was going to go and therefore resigned from the employment. And the deputy head confirmed this. And the letter on his computer confirmed this. So the inquest wasn't aware, didn't have the memory, and 2008 woven around this was one of Khan heartlessly leaving his family and going off to some military training, and the key sentence in this letter had been deleted. The police officer who discovered the inquest did it quite casually, without realising that he was actually blowing the whole story that built up in 2008. That's one of the charms of the 17th story, what I call the ever-changing tale, that you get different generations of storytellers who don't always remember the original version. So anyway, it came out what Khan was doing when he went off. That was his last visit. And he might have spent some time at a had some sort of jihad type camp. What came out? Wahid Ali, he was put on trial in 2008. There were three young men who had the misfortune of being friends of the four at the 2008 trial, if you remember, and they were put on trial for conspiracy to cause explosions in London. And they were let off. The jury was totally unconvinced after a massive 3-month trial. So the government said, no, we don't like that, let's do it again. So they had another massive 3-month trial. And still the jury weren't convinced, but they were put in jail for a different reason, that they were plotting to go off to a jihad camp in Pakistan. Anyway, these three were close friends of the four, and the case, I think, where the government's point at which the government's sort of really fell apart was that these three, while Khan was going off to Pakistan, these three went up to London for a couple of days. And they were supposed to be doing reconnaissance surveying for this 7/7 story. And it turned out that none of them had even been down a tube station at all. They'd driven over the car. And they'd done things like going to the London Aquarium and stuff. I think that was basically the point at which the government story rather fell apart, and why the jury weren't convinced. Quite apart from none of these four having the remotest interest in chemistry or how to make bombs that anyone ever knew about. You probably noticed at the inquest there's an enormous amount of attempted planting of circumstantial evidence, like the so-called bomb factory, Alexander Grove in Leeds. But they planted all sorts of sort of junk that's supposed to look like bomb making equipment. Basically, those four lads involved, nobody could show they had any interest or any chemistry, or that they would have known what hydrogen peroxide was if you put it in front of them. Hydrogen peroxide is always the staple that they try and make out. It's used for the bomb making equipment, to terror bomb plots. So these lads were supposed to have journeyed down to London on the morning of 7/7 with this fiendish dreadful explosive in their rucksack, okay? And that fiendish dreadful explosive kept changing as the storytellers moved on. For example, for about 3 whole years, it was something called TATP, triacetone triphosphate, that was highly detonative and unstable. It needed to be kept cool. And that lasted up until 2008. And then just vanished, just evaporated. Shoom, where's it gone? And instead we had black pepper and peroxide from then onwards for the inquest. What was supposed to rip those trains apart that terrible morning of 7/7 was black pepper and peroxide. That's from 2008 onwards, okay? That appeared in the trial of those three lads. So somehow, you know, the new set of storytellers can just forget what the earlier people have said. And right at the beginning, there was what might have been genuine explosive experts in the days after 7/7. And they said, this is something like C4, a military-grade explosive. And they said they found evidence for it or traces of it around the coaches. Okay. Now, where does Khan come into all this? I like the conjecture which Mohammed made in his ripple effects. Now, so when he first came out with the ripple effect, everyone thought it was a bit far-fetched, because he had them all end up at Canary Wharf getting shot. You know, they come late to London, the trains are all delayed, they arrive too late, they've agreed to take part in a terror drill. Okay? I like Moore Dibb's story in the ripple effect, that they would have approached Khan first. They would approach him first because the police did liaison work with Khan, or rather Khan liaised with the police, because he was good at getting youngsters off drugs, for example. Historic heroin epidemics around Dewsbury, and he was good, had really good effective techniques how to get them off drugs. Okay, cold turkey, go out, rafting, that's a picture of rafting. Here they are. Here's his getting the youngsters off drugs. A team he's taken out to a Welsh rowing outing. There's Tanmere down there, there's Tanmere, and there's Khan, okay? So it's just weeks before the alleged suicide of 7-7. Khan had a reputation for taking people on mountain walks, for example, or just chilling out, not allowing them access to drugs. That was one of the things he could do. His group he had linked to the Ikra bookshop and the sort of gym there. Okay. So the police would have. They did film him in 2004. Police definitely shadowed him and they took film of him. A lot of people believe that this shows he was somehow working for MI5. I think Mohammed probably believes that too. That Khan and Tanmere were somewhere working with MI5, and that's how they got linked to something called the Crevice trial. That they would have been sent by MI5 to try and find out about things. I'm rather doubtful about that, or I require to be convinced. But I'll say Khan did do some filming with them. So he would have tended to trust local police that they could approach him and ask him to do a favour. Okay? For example, after his death, about two months after this film appeared, in which he's apparently making confessions about Finnish attention he has to blow people up in London and so forth, because of Britain bombing other countries. So it's absolutely contrary to everything, the whole non-violent, gentle philosophy of his everything we know about his life and all the friends who ever knew him. And particularly his wife, Frida Patel, was asked about it at this video, and she said, "That's just not my husband speaking. I just do not recognise that person." He's very firm about it. And another fellow, who'd known Khan for many years, at school with Khan, Rob somebody, he said that voice that you hear in that posthumous video isn't Khan's voice. It had a lilting voice. Basically, that was voice morphing technology. That's what you can do when you've got a bit of film of somebody. You just have a few minutes of somebody speaking, and you can then make them say anything you want. But the catch is, the lips will not match up with the sounds that are spoken. And if you watch the Khan video, I think you'll see that the lips do not actually match up with what he's saying. And also the Guardian correspondent went up to Dewsbury when that film came out, and he found the local lads just were not believing that it was Khan. The local lads who had known Khan, they just wouldn't believe that, okay? I think that because of this degree of liaison and trust which Khan would have as a pillar of the local community, he would have tended to accept a suggestion. The police came up, "Look, we've got a big project in London, and we might be able to help you and your friends make a bit of money if you just help us, and this is it. You just have to go up to London early on July the 7th, and we'll give you a dry run on June the 28th just to practice it. It's just a sort of terror drill, resilience, they would in some way have got Khan to rope in his three friends." I think that's quite likely what happened, and quite who did it. I mean, there may have been there's an MI6 agent in Dewsbury who might have been the person who did it, but let's not speculate. I suspect that's quite likely what happened, that he was roped in in this manner with an offer. Okay?
Do you think they would have had contact with Visor consultants at any point?
I think Visor There's a good story here at Luton, which I'll come to, at the Luton train station, where this Jaguar is found. And the Jaguar turns up exactly when the cars arrive, and the same Jaguar happens to be there on June the 28th, which is when they had their dry run. And everyone's wondering, does that belong to Peter Power of Weisel Consultants? And it's quite likely that car, that Jaguar, smart Jaguar, which turned up at Luton station that morning, gave them the rucksacks, for example, the big rucksacks that they carry. That's quite possible. Anyway, those four, let's accept they were all planning to turn up that morning, but then something special happened to Khan. His wife, and I was talking Arshad, by the way, who's his brother-in-law, that's Sina Patel's brother, and I had one talk with him a few years ago, 2008. He described how what Sina Patel also said in that interview with Cathy Etchiam, that she had severe complications and pains from a pregnancy on the 5th of July. And so Khan, there was a car that Tanwir, his fellow friend Tanwir had rented, a little Nissan Micra car. They rented it at the beginning of the week, and they were driving around in it quite a bit. And suddenly, Khan had to take his beautiful young wife, she was seized up with severe stomach cramps, to the hospital. And he then, I think he would then have made the decision to pull out. I can't go on 7-7 operation. I can't go on this run up to London. Perhaps I should just backtrack a bit. On June the 28th, three of them went up, not including Hasib Hussain. They met at Luton Station, and they got the train down from Luton to King's Cross, and then at King's Cross, they wandered around one or two stations, and they ended up at South Kensington. South Kensington is actually the stop you'd end up if you go the three different routes that blew up. One is the Piccadilly line, the other is the Regimental line, the other is the Aldwych line. They'd all converge at South Kensington. So that kind of makes sense, that if they thought they were going past us and where they'd all reunite again. And that 28th of June, Khan is seen eating ice cream in front of Madame Tussauds. So they were basically sort of having fun, I think. I don't think they had any guilty secret on their conscience, okay? So you see them very clearly on the CCTV in London on June the 28th, and unlike the extremely dodgy stuff you get on the July 7th, the CCTV is all perfectly crystal clear. You see them all very clearly, and the timestamps are all properly at the bottom where they should be, and that's an enormous contrast with the fiddled about pictures you get on July 7th. Okay. So we come to the 5th of July now, and Khan's wife is getting stomach cramps. Khan decides he's got to pull out. So those managing the operation have an extremely tricky moment. They've got to persuade the other lads to go ahead with it, even though their main character, Khan, has said he can't do it because of his wife. His wife's pregnancy can be, and he's got to stay within the hospital. His wife then described a haunting way in which all the next day, that's the 6th of July, she frantically kept trying to phone her husband and didn't get through. Then the next morning, on July 7th, she has a miscarriage. Well, how's that for a synchronicity? So that was basically the last anyone sees of her husband is her on the 5th. And then there was a big thing about a phone call early in the 6th of July, which the inquest talked about, of him giving some sort of message to the others about as if he was going to pull out. And the newspapers, you may remember, were trying to make out that it had been postponed. It was due on the 6th of July, postponed itself. No, it wasn't about that. It was about him pulling out from the deal because of this. And perhaps he urged them to go ahead. Anyway, I'm suggesting that somebody, a patsy, these are patsies, that's what they're called, when they're lured into something, when they don't know what the significance is of what they're lured into doing, a patsy cannot just pull out like this and can't sacrifice his life by thinking he could pull out. So I'm suggesting that somewhere around the 6th, he was somehow bumped off, somewhere around Leeds. There's absolutely, I want to suggest to you, and argue, there's absolutely no trace of credible evidence that he was ever in London that morning, whereas I think there is credible evidence that the other three really, really were in London. Okay? Now this is the difference in my new edition of my book, that I'm accepting Lloyd Dibb's story, the Ripple Effect, that the three really did get up to London that morning, and they really did end up at Canary Wharf being shot down. In the previous edition of my book, I was very doubtful whether any of them had got up to London, because, you know, the absence of any, more as absence of any witnesses, absence of CCTV. I think a few years ago, most people didn't believe they were really in London, because the evidence seemed so dodgy. Whereas now, I would say that, I suggest to you, that the reason the authorities could never release the CCTV they had in London, remember years went by, they kept saying, oh, we got it, yeah, we got loads of CCTV. Well, Sharks were saying, oh, no, we can't do that. Or we will do it eventually. There are two reasons why they couldn't show the CCTV. One, Khan wasn't there. Number two, the three who arrived were late. They were too late. And let's just go over that. I was the person who discovered that there was a terrific delay in the trains that morning from Luton King's Cross, and the 7:40 was cancelled. So the perfect crime had been planned. The plotters had masterminded the whole detail. It all would have went perfectly, but somehow, that's what Moore did, called the hand of God, intervened, and the trains, overhead power line complication in the Millhill area, whatever, they're all running 25 minutes late. And so the authorities released CCTV at Luton and the King's Cross of the four, and those CCTVs released with the times are totally incompatible with the train times that actually ran that day. Me and my colleague, we got the actual times of the trains that ran when they arrived, and for a whole year the government was saying they got 7:40, yeah, 7:40, 7:40, yeah, 7:40. Official report, 7:40. Then a year later, finally, three in the House of Commons announces, oh, sorry, somebody was cancelled that morning, they won't run. And the government had to go over what train they thought they might have been on. Oh, well, maybe the 7:25 or something. Well, hang on. And then they make it worse, they produce a whole lot of CCTV showing that I was getting on the 7:25. Well, hang on. If you've got all that CCTV showing these, you know, kids coming around through certain intervals, oh yeah, no, go downstairs, oh, 7:22, no, 7:25 train. If you've got all that CCTV, which they only released 3 years later, right? Do you believe the government if they only released the CCTV 3 years later? If they got all that CCTV, how come for a whole year they were all saying that they got the 7:40? I mean, it's just a totally fabricated situation. They can't have a whole year claiming they got the 7:40 and then claim to have CCTV showing they were on the 7:25. It's like they had the official report, which came out a year later, said, oh, we've got witnesses on the 7:40. Not only their onset, but there were witnesses on the 7:40 that interviewed, who testified to these four lads being on it. And then a few years later at the inquest, that's early this year, oh, they've got witnesses on, what is it, 7:24, 7:25 train. Oh, witnesses seeing that, you know, it's as if they got the same witnesses, but they just shifted the train. So it's a totally fabricated story. And it very much falls apart with the train times. And Mohammed's story, I think it's very credible and compatible with the evidence released at the inquest. They arrive, Hasib was saying, for example, okay, there's a massive load of CCTV released, and Hasib was saying, alone. About 5 to 9 to 9:20, he's alone pottering around King's Cross. Now, I guess we'll never know what he thought he was doing around those girls. But maybe he'd been told to separate off from the others and hang around because he was going to go to some bus an hour later if the bus was scheduled to blow up an hour after the trains, okay? But the fact is, I was there at the inquest and I realised this is totally authentic CCTV that hasn't been fiddled with. Now, that's never made public, but when they make public, they'll adjust it a lot. But all that, I think that was an important experience for me to see that CCTV. And just for the record, the only other bit of CCTV that morning, which I believe was genuine, was up at what's called Woodall Services Station, the M1, about 4 o'clock in the morning, where Tanmere comes out, brightly, it's a bright, cheerful lot, we're all wearing white and stuff, and he comes out, spends 20 quid on petrol, another 20 quid on sweets and crisps and stuff. And you can see Hassi Bazan's with him in the car. By the time he gets to Luton with the dodgy fiddled with photographs, he's changed his trousers, okay? He's wearing dark trousers at Luton. This is the car, little Nissan Micra. It's supposed to have three big lads in, three big rucksacks, and about 9 or 10 bombs with bristling with nails and stuff, which is what they claim to have found left in the Luton car park, okay? And as well as that, cooling devices, if you want to believe all the original stories with TATB, it had cooling devices as well. Even crown solid, because you really get that much into a Nissan Micra. You've got different sets of storytellers in this story, and not least coming over from America. Okay, you've got terrific American input. For example, all the stories of the explosives in the car found in the Luton car park, that all came over from America, the ABC News. So you've got different storytellers feel at liberty to chip in, and they're not allowed to contradict each other, these storytellers. So Tan Weir is at that service station about 4 o'clock in the morning, and he argues with the cashier, he buys some stuff, and I think that's genuine. And also, some people try to make out that you can see Khan in the back of that car. Well, first of all, I don't think you can see him in the back of that car. And secondly, the testimony of the man at the forecourt, Woodall Service Station, at the inquest, under oath, he says there were two people in that car. Two, not three. Now, I accept that testimony, and I believe Khan was not in that car that morning. He was 28th, he went down June 28th. So those two, the young 18-year-old Hassi Hussain and Shrin Tanmir, drove down to Luton, and they met up with their friend who was living in Aylesbury then, Jermaine Lindsay. I'm just telling you bits of story from the inquest here, because it's like human touch. Lindsay arrived an hour earlier, okay, about 5 or 5:20 or something, and he then falls asleep. And the lady comes along with a parking ticket, puts a parking ticket on his van, and sees this guy fast asleep. Now, does that really strike you as a suicide bomber on the hang, on his final appointment with going to paradise? But it's just not off waiting for his friends to arrive. There's a moment when they all meet up together. I'm trying to remember the time. I think it's just a bit before 6 o'clock. Okay? Jermaine Lindsay's woken up, he comes round the parks, and you see it's on CCTV, and then you see the other car, which just arrived, see the lights in the early morning mist, at the very back of the car park, and when that car just arrives, you see the Jaguar in front, the lights go on the Jaguar. So there's a second type synchrony, within seconds. So it must be telephone conversation of the Jaguar and the car that's just arriving from Leeds. Okay, so you see the car with Hassi Hussain and Tanmir drive down and park next to Jermaine Lindsay, okay? And you see the Jaguar driving around and just coming to park behind those two, and at that instant, the CCTV goes off. oh, fancy that, oh gosh, what a surprise. So this thing switches off. So this is, mind you, for example, Lady Di, when her last minutes, you know, all the seems to be in Paris is mysteriously unavailable. So this thing does get switched off at crucial moments in the story, just as it does with 9/11. You know, no seems to be in the main, you know, Denver and Washington airports. The CCTV on the bus is all mysteriously non-functioning. Stagecoach, who run the buses, is adamant that it was perfectly good and okay when they handed it over to the police. And the police say, oh no, no, it was dysfunctional and broken, it wasn't working, there was nothing on it. You know. So this is a story in which CCTV does switch off just when something important is going to happen.
And it was an Israeli company that ran the CCTV, wasn't it?
It's really.
It was an Israeli company that ran the CCTV.
Yeah, thank you. Variant Systems, a security agent, Variant Systems, I think that's a very important point you made. And they're also involved, also Israeli companies involved likewise with the Boston Airport and Logan in 9/11, with the security there. So at Luton, we got to Luton, it just switches off, and we can conjecture that someone, you can't help wondering, was it Peter Barrett, you know, he's the maestro of Britain's terror drills, right, may have got out and given them the rucksacks. Now, it's very important for these lads coming along, they're young, inexperienced, naive, they don't really know, but they need to be reassured. Somebody with a Jaguar who they'd met previously because he was there on June the 28th, okay? He's in the very same position, you know, Luton car park, he's seen the 28th CCTV. It's an important discovery made by the 97th truth campaign. That Jaguar was there before, so it would be someone they knew. So it would have psychologically reassured them. You know, they'd gone up very early in the morning, coming down. And probably they would have been given their rucksacks then, at that stage. And then wander over to the station. I won't go into details, but the authorities kept fiddling about with CCTV. They've got one character, I think it's Tanweer, coming out of the main entrance at 7:15. Out. Others of them going in a couple of minutes later, so you can't really get a coherent story with the various timed CCTV things that they've released there. But what I would say is that Plastic Hussein was really at King's Cross, and masses of CCTV appeared from 9:05 onwards. I believe they did not have CCTV of Plastic Hussein before then. I think the police genuinely got all they've got of him over that period of time. And I think there's evidence that they caught, for example, the 7:48 at Luton. I think that's very possible. Caught 7:48, and that would have got them there. They would have arrived. Hey, what's going on? They'd have seen all these crowds milling around. Started crowds panicking. They arrived too late for what they're supposed to be involved in. Told, you know, you catch this train, you catch that train. They're too late for it, and these crowds are rushing out of the tube at King's Cross. So, let me give you one more glimpse of Jermaine Lindsay, if I may. He appears, there's quite a reliable testimony of someone, a guard, who was just by the ticket barriers, and he'd given this testimony before, an Indian fella, obviously a man of, well, struck me at the inquest, guarding integrity. Because you can't say that for all the witnesses at the inquest. He said, testified, it was definitely Jermaine Lindsay who we met, as the pictures they've seen afterwards. Jermaine Lindsay said, look, something important, he wants to speak to the station manager. And the guy said, oh, come on, just tell me, whatever it is, you can just tell me. And said, no, there's something important, I need to talk to the station manager. And he had some sense of gravity about him. And eventually the guard went off and got the station manager and came back. And by that time, Lindsay had fled. Now, the inquest is very careful not to tell us the time or to ask to estimate the time when it happened, which I think they could have done. Let's say it was about quarter to nine or something. And in that dialogue, there was a revealing dialogue between the guard and Jermaine Lindsay. The guard said, look, because of the station, the crisis that's going on now, or the practice, it's a bit of an emergency. I can't easily contact him. Now, this is before the bombs had gone off. And West asked him, what about the crisis? And he said, well, there were things like loads of policemen walking around and so on. So I think it's important to appreciate that before the bombs went off at King's Cross, there was quite a special atmosphere there. And I think it's to do with the terror drill of Peter Power that morning. It's very hard to get details of what exactly was going on with the terror drill. But I think I believe there was stuff going on at King's Cross that didn't look like an ordinary day, with a whole lot of officials wandering around. And I think that is what would have given Jermaine Lindsay impression of something that he wanted to talk to the manager about. Things would have dawned on him that it wasn't quite right. He begins to realise the awful predicament he was in. So he had fled by the time the station manager arrived, this guy brought him. Now, I think that's the last glimpse we get of him. It's just a testament of the inquest that I think brings these characters slightly into focus on that dreadful day, what they were really doing. So we have direct evidence of two of them really being at King's Cross. I suggest to you that in terms of why I'm suggesting Khan wasn't here, I'm sure you're all familiar with this picture. Experts say these look like they're all photoshopped, okay? This guy has got impossible anatomy. That foot is totally crooked. Look, there's a gap there. That knee goes out to his plastic bag. Here, this guy's somehow interacting with a lamppost in a way that he shouldn't if it's a real photo. This fella, he's got straight lines down the side of his leg. This fella's got an aura around his head, supposed to be calm. Photoshop experts have given this kind of detail, okay? Now the Khan, you'll notice these bars go right in front of him on two occasions, okay? Now the inquest discusses, oh no, nothing wrong with that picture, it's just that somehow he's got his arm folded. Well, that isn't just an arm folded, you know. Why would anyone present Photoshop forgery as bad as this?
There's a reflection into that chapel there of something that's non-existent. The guy in the foreground with the white, that chap that's interacting with the lamppost, as you put it.
Yeah.
Just there, where your finger is, if you move your finger down slightly.
Yeah.
And across, away from his crotch. There you go. Down slightly. You'll notice some linear that's just at the side of his leg.
It's
as if there's a shadow of something that isn't there.
But also there's reflection. That's some black glass there. So if you meet some real 7-7 buffs, they will tell you that these things are not mirror reverse like they ought to be with the laws of optics.
Yeah.
They should be switched over. And they're actually not. You can see details of them being the same way. So it's as if, my feeling is that whoever did this wanted to give clues, but by doing incredibly bad Photoshop, saying like, look, we don't enjoy doing this sort of stuff, but we have to. Anyway, there is Khan. That is the only photo of Khan. I think that's the only photo of Khan on July 7th. Okay?
Yeah. I think I've shown a live, mobile video that includes the call.
3 years later, 3 years later, at the so-called Jameson trial, Jameson trial of 2008, they released a sequence with that image as one of them. That is supposed to show of sort of, you know, 3 second intervals of them walking down this street and going in. Yeah, it is, yeah.
You're always convinced that's forgery as well.
Well, I'm not convinced that it's genuine. The four of them did not walk into that station in the morning. I'm convinced that Khan was not with them. And I think this kind of thing is part of the evidence. Let me give you another bit of evidence why I think Khan wasn't there. ID of Khan was found on three different blast sites, okay? the edge-of-a-round tube, where he's supposed to have been, the tally starts square number 30 bus, and then the Aldrich. They're going, oh, here's his, you know, birth certificate or address book, or here's his swimming pool club thing. So somehow, somebody committing jihad managed, clever enough, to get his ID on three different blast sites of the London bombings. Now, what do you make of that? Does that increase the evidence that he was there, or does it demonstrate that he wasn't there at all? Does it show you the perpetrators are getting rather confused with their story? Well, at the inquest, you're wondering, can the story get any sillier than this? At the inquest, they had further ID of Khan found, his mobile phone, no less, mobile phone, on the Piccadilly line train. Oh, so all four sites now have remains of Khan. Oh, fancy that. And the phone not only was found, but it had a phone call on it that he'd made on the morning of the 6th of July or something, you know. Now, what I find mysterious about this is the British media do not comment at all. You know, you thought somebody would say, wait a minute, are we being asked to believe this? A final ID remains of one character at all four different blast sites. You thought some journalist somewhere might have commented, okay? Let me make a general statement that throughout the entire 5 months of the inquest, there was virtually no intelligent debate or comment from any British journalist at all, except possibly when the question of MI5 were being dragged in. Lady Justice Hannah was dragging in MI5 as a witness, if you remember. And MI5 said, oh no, we don't testify in public. And Lady Justice Hannah said, oh yes, you do. And they retaliated by getting some rather low-level MI5 guy who really didn't know anything much to the inquest, didn't really tell them anything. Anyway, that was the one bit where British journalists felt able to discuss things, just a little bit, okay? But it's as if British journalists had total mental paralysis. In fact, I think the adjectives I use in my book are amnesiac, credulous and obedient towards whatever they're told. And you may wonder, what happened to British journalism? You know, how did we get into this situation? But they're not allowed to think about anything. And you even get remains of Khan on all four different blast sites, and you get a picture like that as the only picture. I mean, wouldn't you expect one journalist to comment, excuse me, is this really a photograph of Khan? Is that what he looks like? No, they don't. No, not a single journalist, no. They all talk about how the fiendish... Yeah? This fiendish terrorist menace, you know. So you sort of wonder what's going on. What's going on, obviously, is a fabricated story. It's the fabricated myth of Al-Qaeda with bin Laden being set up. And it's a theft of identity that goes on. Just as they kind of stole bin Laden's identity and they pretended he was alive in 2001 when he in fact died. Kept him alive for 9 years with endless fake tapes and videos made in Pakistan by the ISI, the Pakistani intelligence. So they've stolen the identity of Mohammed Sidique Khan. And I think it's so important that we try to get the real identity. Let's try to make some affirmations. I think I've got seven affirmations here that made about Khan. Okay, what he did in only 30 years of his life. Some business work he was involved with. I can't quite remember the details of that. He was invited up to Parliament, and Hilary Bent came down to open the Hamara Healthy Living Centre in... it's Beeston, isn't it? Hamara Healthy Living Centre. He came down to open that, okay? We looked at this, and drugs, and he was proud of the way when rival gangs were in the street threatening to have a fight, that he could defuse it by helping them to see each other's point of view. And he put that in his CV, applying for his job, his ability to resolve conflict. People trusted him. Mothers would take their little girls to the school, in a car he had. He can collect them on the way to school. After the event, a lot of these parents of the school just wouldn't believe what was said about the car. Okay? Yeah, I should mention that. I think he did quite a lot for both the Beeston and Dewsbury areas where he was known. Associated with the Hamara Living Centre and also the ICRA bookshop, which had some sort of gym underneath it, didn't it? Do you remember the story with the ICRA bookshop? The police came and wanted to break into it. And the guy and said, well, okay, here's the key if you want to get in. I said, no, I don't want the key. And they battered the door down, like battering around. So smashed their way in. And then alleged there was terror material they were confiscating. And some of the terror material turned out to be John Pilger's books. So he was quite annoyed by this and wrote his account of the ICRA bookshop story. I went up in a year or so after the event. And we talked to some locals about that ICRA bookshop, and it's what would be called, say, truth videos, for example, about what really happened on 9/11. If Muslims, a shop sells that, they're liable to be accused. The police are liable to call that terror material. Okay, I think that's part of the trouble with this anti-terror legislation that enables the police to make a crime out of practically anything they want to. That's the undefined nature of all the anti-terror legislation we've had through the Blair government. Okay, that's just from the film The Phantom Menace. And this is what we're given today. We're endlessly given the illusion of terror, phantom menace, to help everybody live in fear. When you've got no good politicians, with absolutely no vision or hope whatsoever, how to improve your lives, they will manipulate you through fear, okay? That's the name of the game from 9/11 onwards. They are creating fear because that's the only way they can get you to listen to them. But otherwise, they've got nothing of any value to say to you. They've got no possible way of helping your life or improving your life, but they do want your tax money so they can spend it on the military, and they need to fabricate the enemy for that. This has been going on since Machiavelli sort of warned about it, but it's acquired a darn terrible new relevance in this 21st century because of the faculty of digitally fabricating images. We have fabricated terror events, and it's the anti-terror command especially that does it, okay? If you want to look at other terror events, like say the Bali bomb, who did the Bali bomb, it's very much the anti-terror people who get big sums of money, America, what's called security and anti-terror work, and they pocket the money and they create the terror event to make clear that sort of why they need it, okay? I'd like you all to be familiar with the Madrid bombing on the 3rd of March, 11th of March, 11/3, the Madrid bombing, which was the very day after a big NATO anti-terror exercise. NATO holds anti-terror drills, holds this big military exercise once a year, okay, and about 5 days. And that year, 2004, it was all about counter-terror command in capital cities of Europe, okay? So counter-terror exercises involve military liaising with the police. Now, that's exactly what you don't want if you want to live in a healthy society. You don't want the military liaising with the police, right? You want the police to be quite independent. But that liaison is exactly what you have to have for fabricated terror to work, false flag terror to work. The military needs to be able to get into those crucial areas to be able to make terror happen. But it's only a very, very small number of people who actually know that is being done. Most of the people in the exercise will have no idea that anything of this kind is happening and will not ever believe it's happening. So but it gives the perfect cover and alibi, just as Peter Powers visa consultant exercise that morning with the exact same three train stations and the exact moment when the bombs actually went off. That was the cover for the event happening. Okay? That is totally central for fabricated terror. You have to have excuses and covers for the event, for people to go in and prepare it. Okay? Give me an example, another example. I hope you've all seen the film V for Vendetta. Okay, terrific drama. And it was filmed in the months leading up to 7/7, March to June 2005. Warner Brothers, it's all about a train on an underground being made and prepared to explode, if you remember. Okay? So you've got Warner Brothers snooping around the underground with a train being prepared to explode. That is the kind of cover that is needed to prepare a fabricated terror event. But whoever you think actually did it, that would have been a help for them, okay?
It's also the Old Bailey that gets it first.
The
Old Bailey gets it first.
Oh, does it? Oh,
right. In the film. And okay. Obviously that is the common law.
Yeah, right, okay. Let's see what's here. Yeah, well, we're all given, we're all being taken for a ride with the level of, they keep altering the level of terror, you know. Is it severe? How frightened do you have to be, you know? Can we get out of bed? Are we too scared to get out of bed in the morning, or what? So the government now tells us how frightened we have to be, okay? And it gets embarrassing if they put it up to severe for a whole year and nothing much happens. You know, what's going on? So this is the name of the game now, after 9/11, it's a sort of weakness of the character of rich people. I like in your comments on it. It's a weakness of the character of rich people. They are reassured if the government gives them an enemy image to hate and fear. It will be very difficult to govern this country without a demonised enemy image out there that we might have to fight, and so forth. I'd appreciate any thoughts you might have on this. That in a sense, the government does what we ask it to do by providing enemies. Okay? Now it's Muslims. Was the Germans, was the Russians, now it's Muslims. Okay? So here's the reassurance that we all have. We're the most highly CCTV'd area on planet Earth. Does that make you feel safe? How many times is it? 200 times a week or something? Anyway, you get photographed. Perhaps there's not so much here up in Leeds. Okay. Shall I go over a bit the story? Have you had enough? I can go over a bit the story of the tube and where they put Khan in the inquest, if you like. All right?
Yeah, please.
Okay. This is the Edgware Road line. Generally speaking, the government simply cannot find any witnesses who will say they saw any of these terrorists at all. Okay, that's generally the position. So it puts Khan here, okay, and this is where it thinks the blast is, approximate position of the blast. Okay? And a chap called Biddle here, and a chap called Tullock there, Tullock. Okay. Now you'll notice that it's not exactly the same place. Khan's here. He's holding his rucksack. Now Biddle's there. Biddle gets, it's real false memory syndrome. Biddle gets both legs blown off, one eye blinded, gets smashed out through the doors of the tube, he's in a coma for 2 months in a hospital. And while he's in a coma, he sees that posthumous Khan video. Okay, so he's totally given the idea, while still in a coma, of this wicked Khan. And obviously, people keep endlessly asking the same question. Did you see Khan? You know, it's like that's the one thing you keep asking. So anybody who was in this area is under terrific pressure to say, did you see Khan? You know. So to start with, he has a memory of Khan being right next to him and looking him straight in the eye, and then Khan pulls the plug or something and blows up. Khan blows up into a whole lot of tiny little pieces, and he has to do that. Because at the inquest, they count the number of dead. And they have a real count by a real expert. who will testify the number of really dead people in the coach, okay? And the number of really dead people is then matched up with all the names. They damn well have to get that right, okay? Now, that does not leave over who you can say that was the terrorist. There's no leftover body that they can say, oh, that's Khan. Okay? So that's why he has to blow up into a large number of little bits, so he's not seen by somebody as a dead body. And I think the same applies to Tan Weir in another coach, that he likewise has to blow up into a large number of different bits. Okay, so that's Biddle's first story. Then Biddle's second story, he says, oh, I looked around, there he was over there. So he looks over there and sees him, and he's got the rucksack on his lap, and he looks at him. So Biddle thinks he makes eye contact again, and he pulls the plug, and bang. I think he then gives one more story where he has Khan standing up again. Okay. Now, at the inquest, Biddle definitely had Khan there. So, obviously the inquest doesn't like having him 10 feet away from where the hole in the floor is. The inquest isn't keen on having Khan with the rucksack blowing up in his lap, and there's no hole underneath him. Oh, the hole's 10 feet away. Ah. Just talk us through that, will you, please? Just explain that. Just go over that one more time, will you? That the hole in the floor is 10 foot away from Khan. So, fortunately, you've got totally amnesiac, incredulous British journalists who will not question anything. And so that Biddle story is then, in terms of why it happens, because in other areas British journalists can be perfectly critical, it's the depth of fear and terror that is projected that blots out rational thought. When you've got a hated enemy image, that is a way to block out rational thought amongst the community. That's a fundamental technique by those who weave the webs of delusion. So they're not too heavy. So Biddle is horrified by this terrorist, he's got both of his legs blown off, and who is there questioning his testimony? Well, his testimony does flip about like a flag on a pole. It's obviously false memory syndrome. The people opposite don't see Khan at all, and the reason no one's sitting next to him is pretty obviously because they didn't want anyone sitting next to him. They could say, no, I didn't notice him at all. Okay, now there's a lot of further testimony on this carriage, and I published an article about three major holes in the floor of the Edgware Road coach. Now, you can't have a suicide bomber rucksack making three major holes in the floor of the Edgware Road coach. You really can't. In all three of those holes, somebody falls into the hole, and we have harrowing descriptions. If one person dies, and the other two, they get out. There's a hole there, hole there, but that's Tullock, Professor Tullock, a media professor, quite a VIP, who was sitting there, and he survives a hole being blown about there. Another huge hole here, somebody falls into that, and they die. And all their legs are mangled, because whatever was happening under the coach, and he died because his legs were mangled after he fell into that hole, right? The other two, that holes, the person managed to get out. But there's harrowing testimony from somebody called John. He gave it to the 2006 London Assembly about in the dark climbing along with this huge hole he came across where the metal twisted upwards. Okay? Metal's twisted upwards from the hole and so it could easily tear you. And he fell down that hole and he thought he was going to die. So he managed to pull him out. And he then gave that testimony again to this inquest. And that is clearly the hole here. It's clearly that hole that he fell into. Because you've got Tullock describing it as well. Tullock describes how he moved around over there to avoid that hole. Okay. Then you've got this hole here, which is near that double door, and that again has somebody in it who's dying, and there's very harrowing accounts of people trying to rescue him and seeing him dying. Okay. Then, brand new evidence in this inquest is a hole here. I'd like to go through that with you. You get the driver of the train called Ray Whitehurst, who's now to give testimony at the inquest. Now, when I was doing my book, none of us could get the names of the train drivers. They were totally hidden away from them. Totally, official and not allowed to speak. So what was it so terrible? Why could we not be told who the driver of this Edgware Road train was? Well, he gives his testimony, and it's so funny because he's not in the same condition of shock as all the other people. He's not traumatised by a life and death experience. He's driving his train, and the bang goes up, it lifts up, and he's thrown forward. He hits his head on the front of the front driver coaches him. It stops very abruptly, the train. Okay. At this point, I'll just flash back to the classic testimony of Edgware Road. Check on Mark Honigbaum. He's a Guardian journalist. He's standing outside of Edgware Road all the morning of 7-7, getting all the stories, and he gives an audio report, which he speaks, and sends to the Guardian. And that describes the train being, that coach being lifted up by the blast, lifted up and crashing down again, and people describing holes in the floor, and old people with their legs and feet blown off. That's a totally recurrent, centrally important theme of people on the coaches, the three coaches that morning. It's nearly always the feet and legs that get blown off, not the hands, not the face. Okay, and that's totally ignored in all government discussion, all government testimony, all British media commentary. That they totally ignore the central important fact. Feet and legs being blown off. Okay, Mark Honigbaum, he gives us in, this is so important because it's before the official story is crystallised. And he then becomes very embarrassed that he said all this stuff about the train being lifted up off the track and so on, and the holes being blown sort of that way. And he tries to backtrack on it. But so many people have copied that audio file that the guys, you cannot delete it from the web, so it's still there. They obviously didn't publish it, they couldn't publish it, because once the official story came in, that Mark Honigbaum testimony couldn't be published, right? Because you can't have a suicide bomber going off inside the coach, which lifts up the coach off the rail. Our basic sort of physics and momentum and stuff. Okay, so I suggest to you that Mark Honigbaum testimony is totally validated by the testimony that we had at the inquest. Okay, so the driver, Ray White, to us at the inquest, the first time we hear from him, he's allowed out, he testifies, and he experiences his train being lifted up, and he walks through the first coach, okay? He walks through the first coach to see what's happened, and it's the second coach that's blown up. This is the second coach, okay? Second coach. He walks through the first coach, and he wonders, can he step through to get into the second coach? And there's somebody sprawled across the connecting thing between the two coaches, and he realises he cannot step over that person because of the huge hole right at the front of the next coach. So he has to get down, dismount from that coach, walk along, and get back up to get into to see the horror of what happened in the second coach. Okay, that is his testimony of the huge hole that appeared, of the hole that appeared there. Now there's another person, I think it's number three, here he is, Daniel Belton or something, who described falling into that hole and thinking he'd died. These are very moving, very graphic testimonies. There's some woman, like some sort of angel came and rescued him when he felt he was dying and carried him back. So that's his testimony. So you've got three holes, minimum three major holes in this Edgware Road, in the Edgware Road coach, and none of the holes are anywhere near where Khan's positioned here. Okay, so Khan is about as non-existent as you can be. And also, Biddle's testimony, that's what Khan looked like. I would say he looked like just an ordinary commuter. Well, you can't look both ways. The photos they produced of Khan with his white cap and stuff don't look remotely like an ordinary commuter. So Biddle obviously hasn't got a memory of seeing Khan. We're just under terrific pressure to do so. Okay, so I think that Edgware Road testimony we've got so far conclusively refutes the idea of any suicide bomber, conclusively refutes the idea of any single rucksack blowing up, and we could go into detail with the other two coaches that where the rucksack blew up. It doesn't match the holes and the position of the dead. By the way, these red figures, that's quite helpful. These are positions of the dead, which they're trying to reconstruct. some of the dead. they just don't match up with the alleged position of terrorists at all. You just cannot do it. So I have a thought that Sergio wrote for it is yet another conclusive proof that Khan wasn't anywhere around there. Whatever it is that blew up that coach, such terrible havoc, I think you've really got to look underneath the train.
Are there any nails found?
No.
Checking nails, were
really. Yeah, the pictures.
The Nissan car was full of nails, you said.
So?
You said the Nissan car that you had was full of nails.
So, yeah, that was released from America. These are scary pictures. Milk bottles full of bombs with nails all attached around, just to make everybody frightened, okay? But there's no nails. No, absolutely no hint of people having nails in the bodies. That's a bit similar, I'll make an analogy with Madrid. There was a big planted rucksack of explosives with nails and nuts and bolts in, found after the event, left behind as it were, that led back to the poor Muslims who got arrested. But experts were emphatic that the people killed did not have nails or nuts and bolts in them. So that's a good point, yeah.
What was the train disposed of, so nobody could check? That is a
terrible fact about this. Nobody was ever allowed to see the coaches. I heard someone say that victim families were allowed to see the coaches, but no member of the public, no journalist or ordinary public could ever see the coaches. And about a year later, they were destroyed, which is in itself a criminal act. You're destroying the evidence of the crime. Police need to. If there was a criminal investigation going on a year later, which I think there was, then just destroying the central evidence of the scene of the crime has to be a criminal act and shows a sinister intention. I think those coaches, first of all, have multiple holes in the floor. Secondly, I think the holes are blown up. Thirdly, I think the windows imploded. I think people. Extraordinary experiences had glass coming into them from an implosion. And the one or two photos you have been shown, which don't really reveal much, have the whole side of the coach removed, doors removed, windows removed, and I think that's because they imploded and they don't want you to see that.
Were there any Asian people killed on that trip, other than Cap?
Well, Edgware Road is a very high Muslim population. You could just go through the, I would think, yes, loads of them. You just go through the names here, hear the names.
Right.
And it's very helpful what the police did with these maps they gave to the inquest enabled you the first time to get a picture of what blew up. And generally speaking, with the three coaches, what blew up was very elongated. It's in the centre, and imagine a series of holes or some elongated explosion down the central axis of the carriage. That's what I'd say, sort of generalisation of what blew up. And they've been trying hard to fix it up with stories of three terrorists, but it doesn't match up at all, really. Any questions or comments?
Why would the windows be imploded?
Because the explosion, let's put it this way, people were asked what they saw, right?
Yes.
People maybe the cabin behind or whatever, and they would describe flashing orange light or orange fires along the outside of the coach, right, on the walls.
Yeah.
They would sometimes describe a fireball coming down through the coach. Mm-hmm. And when they, very interesting, the Piccadilly Line coach, all the people in the coach that exploded, or most of them, were sitting outside Russell Square Station for quite a while, wondering what happened to them. And we have a record of their conversation. And they were trying to decide, had it been derailed, maybe hit the side of the wall, or was it a power surge? That's what they were wondering. And then the driver comes along, and you expect the driver to tell them, oh, come on, you lot, it was a bomb. Don't you realise a bomb or not? And he didn't. He didn't tell them that. I think he said something about a power surge. It's only later, when the Tavistock Square bus blows up, but the story of the bomb, then that's at basically 10:45, that's when the story of the bomb starts to be promoted. And we might say then that by that time the three lads have been shot at Canary Wharf. Sorry, I'm rather cutting them short, but it's quite easy for them, King's Cross, to just jump on the same line they get off from and end up at Canary Wharf. And the reports are they're shot by them, by some sort of counter-terror squad. And after that, a story of bombs going off appears. Does that answer your question?
It does, thank you.
Not for forgiving me, I've got a bloody headache, but just one question. What occurred to me a while ago when you said about they turned up late, so they weren't able to get on the trains effectively. That's been proved.
Yeah.
So, did the authorities expect them to be killed? How could they be sure that they'd be killed on the trains? Because they were dud bombed, presumably.
Yeah.
I don't suppose you'll be able to answer this, actually.
No, I can't answer it.
What were they planning to do
with them?
Because surely the Canary Wharf thing was a contingency plan that had to be put into place. So these guys are still alive, we've got to take them out.
Yeah.
You know, so what were they going to do with them if they hadn't been
alive? They were very sure that they had mobile phones with them. That was an important part of the thing. They're all provided with mobile phones, and they can be traced by mobile phones. I suppose that was how they could be traced to Canary Wharf. They may not quite realise that it was having the mobile phones on them that's how they could be got. So as long as they kept those mobile phones, they could be caught. Obviously,
presumably though, there's a chance they could have just got injured in the bombs if they would have been on time.
Yeah.
And then they would have been free to give testimony from the hospital beds, presumably, something like that.
Well, we can only conjecture.
Just speculation. But that was the plan from Visor Consult to have them on the trains when they explode.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be perfectly feasible for the controllers to be very specific as to which carriage and which, or perhaps?
Well, they wouldn't have known which carriages they were going to get on, presumably, would they?
No, they could have been told at that platform to get on the third carriage or whatever and sit on. They may have been given two or three different options to sit on, which might explain the fact that there was a number of holes, you know, coming underneath. If they sat very close to each one of those three options, one of them was going to take them out.
It'd be interesting if they have seat numbers on the trains, wouldn't it? Because they might have said seat number 12 for you.
You get into very complicated speculations. For example, the main government agent in this story is a lady called a woman, Rachel North, who suddenly becomes the main correspondent on the BBC's website and suddenly articulating the whole government name in that narrative. And she claims to have been on that Piccadilly Line front coach. Now, she's got a previous history of having stories that get in the newspapers, like claiming she was raped and stuff. And you wonder, how did they get her onto that coach? And a lot of people believe that she was actually on the coach behind, that her testimonies aren't authentic, and that she only got the stories from people after a few days and reconstructed them. And that it's more likely she was on the coach behind. So that's the kind of conjecture that was she somehow put there? Because people find it's a bit unlikely that would be just coincidence, but just happening to be there, this perfect sort of MI5 asset type person.
How does the Brazilian lad get into the Brazilian entry?
Yeah, he's not evidently connected. It's only pure conjecture. There's an alleged connection with the 21-7, which I've mentioned 2 weeks later. Those lads who were. Alleged resemblance of the Menzies with one of those. I mean, all I can say is that the 21-7 was a kind of repeat performance with live people, alleged terrorists, so everyone could see them because these people, the previous four, weren't live. And then De Menzies was kind of distract attention from them and confuse everybody. But there's no real evident connection.
I mean, I would just suggest that, firstly, that they might well have been asked to sit where the bombs were going to go off, but that even if that wasn't the case, there's obviously the possibility for numerous contingencies to deal with them, because you know, we see how the whole thing seems to be some sort of construction and fabrication. So even if they survived, who's going to believe them? It's like
they think of someone, won't they?
Yeah, it's like, well, you've got this bomb on you. Your mate managed to blow up himself. You didn't manage to blow yourself up. You've got this bomb on you. It, you know, it's a mock bomb. But, I mean, who's going to check that? Everybody's in their pocket.
Yeah.
And so, you know,
that is possibility.
You've got to hit the trains first, and so they've been able to deal with it. They've been able to finish him off. Or
yeah.
I mean, that's one of the weird twists in the story. That there's no earthly reason why, if the story were correct, why these four lads would want to die. I mean, Tan Weir, for example, his bomb went off about 15 feet away from where he was allegedly standing in the coach. Now, was he there or not? Or did he, do you want to believe he just put his rucksack down on the floor? If he did, why would he want to die? You've got several people, two of them, alleged to put rucksacks down on the floor. If they did that, why would they want to die? You know, why wouldn't they walk away from it?
How do you think Moore did got this information about the Canary War?
Oh, I can answer that. He's got a friend called Gareth, who came out 3 years later, and he was working at Canary Wharf, and he came out with a whole lot of testimony about that story, and Munda told me that Gareth told him that a day or so after the event. And so that's where he got the idea from. Now, in my first edition of my book, I just put that as a conjecture. And what happened after that was, there's a philosopher up in Sheffield called Rory Ridley Duff. Okay, he lectures in the business studies department, gives some philosophy type teachings to students about how to reason properly, you know. And he, one of his modules was comparing the story of the ripple effect with the story of the BBC conspiracy files. Okay? BBC was the orthodox government story, and that didn't mention Canary Wharf, and Ripple Effect did. And he weighed up these, and by weighing them up, he had access to a full database of newspapers around the world, okay, for his academic position. So he could search for all the stories about Canary Wharf that morning. And he found about, I think about 17 of them, you know, a lot. Basically, although that was blocked out from the British news, there was a lot. And one really interesting one, only reported in America, 1:45 that morning, July 7th, there were three police officers making a public statement. Is it Brian Paddock? Anyway, they were asked the question, is it true that terrorists were shot down at Canary Wharf at 10:30 this morning? And the reply was, the Metropolitan Police had not shot any terrorists that morning. And that was a perfectly true statement, wasn't it? Because it was a special hit team that would have done that, just as the special hit team with Demenses, probably something called the SRR, Special Reconnaissance Regiment, which was just set up a few months earlier. Might have been the group that they seconded over from Northern Ireland, had skills in bomb-making equipment, and they were rather above the law and highly secretive, you know, the usual stuff.
Do you think they could have even provided them with special mobile phones to track them?
Yeah, they did. I said so.
Didn't
I say that?
You did say so.
I said so at the inquest, didn't I? I think that was... No, I got it wrong. Anyway, they had various mobile phones. The inquest, they testified... Sorry, not the one. But at the inquest, and also at the 2008 trial, so the various different mobile phones these lads had. So it looked very much as if they were provided by an EI.
But in any case, any mobile can be tracked because it locks onto the nearest transmitter.
Yeah.
So you can pin it down in the radius.
Yeah.
If you know the number.
Yeah.
If you know the phone number.
Yeah.
Which you know.
Yeah. so I was just saying that the really Duff very much that validated the whole Canary Wharf story. And with the Canary Wharf story, there's one report of two being shot down, and then another one, maybe a bit later, of one being shot down. Now, it's very credible that two of them, Hassi Bazan and Tanweer, went off there and got shot down. But I would not say what happened to Hassi Bazan, who would say he was hanging around King's Cross for quite a lot longer, and his story was that he was supposed to get on the bus at Tavistock Square. Now, the photos do shine with his mobile phone quite a lot, and maybe he picked up a call from those two lads saying, I'm going to say, we're going off to Canary Wharf, come over and join us. So if you like, you can believe that. That's quite possible.
It's quite a scary prospect if the police or special forces don't have to fill out forms as long as you're at, if they execute somebody anyway.
Well, that is the Operation Kratos protocol. I don't know if you'd like to criminalise it, but it's with the Tremens assassination, the British public suddenly learned that the police had trained themselves with the Israeli army about how to shoot terrorists in the head, suspected terrorists in the head, very quickly. You have to be allegedly alarmed that they might be about to blow themselves up, okay? And then you're allowed to do it. So I think we're still totally aghast and gobsmacked that the police should be allowed to take a decision to assassinate somebody like that without any approval from Parliament or the British public or anything. But that, as far as I can tell, that seems to be what happened.
There should be a report after it. They haven't done that, should there?
Should be a report after it. The reports of the Canary Wharf said they had something like bombs around the waist. Now, that's what the story has to be to allow them to shoot. There has to be some claim, or they look like terrorists. Well, obviously, they didn't have bombs around the waist, but that was the story which sounds like the Kratos protocol. Yeah.
You haven't mentioned the bus which was blown up.
No.
Are they connected, do you believe?
That's a whole story.
There's not enough time to cover that.
What should I say about that?
It was
a unique journey. Now, that ferry bus doesn't ever normally go that route, and the story was that Euston was blocked off with red yellow tape because of all the crowds coming out of the King's Cross. I suppose that's just about credible. Daniel Abchik has a story, a very vivid story. I don't believe he was on the bus. I was convinced he was not on the bus. I don't really want to start going into anything, but his testimony is totally incompatible with what came out of the inquest. He said, for example, he was adamant, the only people on the ladder deck of the bus was him and four women. You always said that. It's in his book. And the bus was fairly packed out with people, none of whom, sitting directly opposite, recognised or remembered him at all. He's very distinctive, very distinctive. Six or three black, without any hair. You notice him if he was there, especially if he did what he claimed to do, which was fall down flat on the floor and leap up. It's all just fantasy, but I think he might have been in the square somewhere. And he's very aware of, I spent a while talking to him, because I did try to believe him for some time. So I wouldn't recommend that as part of the story of the third bus, but it was strange the way the bus driver drove along this route that no 30 bus had been on before, and then he stopped right outside the BMA and he asked the way. The bus driver asked the way, and just as he asked the way, his bus blew up. And he then, after a few minutes, he then goes off and he walks right across the other side of town, right across West London, which a bus driver shouldn't do. He shouldn't abandon due to a care. And everything about that ferry bus is so bizarre. I mean, you have pictures, a whole lot of people standing up on the top deck, hardly injured at all. At least 12 people. They look fairly nonchalant about their lighting up a cigarette or something. And smartly dressed, you know. You're not given a time sequence of the photographs here, but...
And there's a suspect white van spotted, isn't there?
The King's Star van is there in all pictures. It's there before the bus blows up, during and afterwards, specialists who control the ammunition. It's an incredibly symbolic image, isn't it? With absolute terror, bold and brilliant on the side of the bus. You know, it's the Empire totally showing you what's what. The film The Descent was due to open on the 8th. That's the film advertised inside the bus. Now it had to be postponed because it was about people being trapped and dying underground. And while there were really people trapped and dying underground, they didn't want to release the film. So that film had to be postponed. As with all of them, I haven't really gone into this. I think there's a mystery of what blew up. I haven't really gone into this, but you really don't have any witness saying a bomb went off. You have people having a rather strange experience, actually, which would be a whole different subject to go into. Because people suddenly find themselves, I'm down on the pavement. Oh, how did I get down here? From being on the upper deck. You have the position where they put Hassi Hussein in the bus, right? Sorry, have I not boring you? Am I going into that?
No.
Position where they put Hassi Hussein in the bus. And you get people sitting right next to him, being grilled at the inquest, obviously honest. You know, did you see him? You know, the lead up big question, did you see him? And the person looks rather blank and upset and says, sorry, no. You know. There's one lady, Lisa French, and all the newspapers say, oh, Lisa, oh, I saw Hassi Hussein. Yes, where are rucksack? Oh. So at last, the inquest has got somebody who saw one of the terrorists. So this is the big deal. And you come a bit closer to the story. Well, for about 5 years previously, this lady, Lisa French, has been with no hint that she saw Hassi Hussein. Right? She's telling and retelling a story and getting therapy and trying to cope with the trauma of it. And no hint of seeing the terrorist. And then it turns out she's going upstairs to this guy. And what he's got in his back is actually a laptop, square laptop type bag he's carrying. And he's got sunglasses. Well, hang on, it hasn't been able to wear sunglasses. And he sits about 5 or 6 seats down from her. He's not next to her. Well, there are various people wearing casual type bags over their back that would really fit her account just as well. So I don't think she. I think again she's under terrific pressure. The deal is like, look, just say yes to this question, and we'll make you famous. You know, that's all. And so she did for the inquest. You know, the inquest got a big thrill to have a witness who claimed to see a terrorist. But I don't think the 18-year-old Hassi Hussein was there. Nobody saw him because he wasn't there. What was
this eerie? A psychological thing?
Me?
It was purely psychological.
Sorry, what was that?
The whole imagery was just psychological.
No, it really blew up. It really blew up. What was eerie about it, when you saw pictures of the bus blowing up, which I don't think I've got here, was the level straight line when the top lifted off. It had obviously been cut and prepared. Absolutely dead level straight line all along the top deck of the bus when the top lifted off. And there was one bit in the front corner where you can see it's been halfway sawn across. It was meant to come off, and you can still see the saw mark at that where it's been cut. So I think it was totally prepared beforehand. And also there's an eerie echo of that bus in the 2008 Olympic Games in Beijing, 8808. Was it 8?
No.
Did I get it right? 2008, yeah. And then, you know, a red bus comes in and the top exactly lifts off. And a whole lot of weird, sinister, black magic type things in it. With 13, people 13 are cavorting around, 13 people. That's the number of people allegedly died on this bus. So the top of the bus lifting off, looking just like the 77 bus from Tavistock Square, is...
Have you got money on tribute to that?
Yeah, there is quite a
bit of evidence.
Yeah, I think I'll put it up on my website. And then there's a whole lot of story about Tavistock Square and the Tavistock Institute that I was not able to verify very well, I didn't put in my book, about mind control techniques. And any book about mind control is going to talk about the Tavistock Institute, which in the early 20th century was located there, Tavistock Square.
That's the point I was making, it's like psychological warfare.
Yeah.
With the tube bombs, you're not seeing it.
Mm-hmm.
You need
something above in plain view, whereas all that's contained underground.
Yeah, that's very true. Yeah. Would you like to tell us a bit more about that?
Especially the Tavistock Institute, I mean, like you say, they can be traced back, they create the Beatles, they create the teenager, you know, there's like a warfare on humanity from that area.
Yeah. Well, official psychology books say that they dealt with psychological stress after war. Coping with trauma of war stress. That's what they officially say. And you always wonder what went to it. A friend of mine, Keith Motherson, who helped me on the back, he's on the back cover of my book, and his grandfather really, really was a founder of the Tavistock Institute. And he died under all mysterious circumstances in a terrible way, just as the book was coming out. He was trying to ask his family what was really going on with the Tavistock Institute, what really did they do? What sort of thing did they really get up to? Also, I think it's mysterious how many did die at Tavistock Square. Initial reports, I think the Evening Standard that day, the morning newspaper, morning TV reports were about three people died. Three. From the bus. I went round all of the photographs available. And I saw about three bodies while I was composing my book. About three bodies. When the driver of the bus, what's it happened to George somebody, the Greek driver, he went off to Greece, okay, and then his Greek family, his uncle or something, was interviewed in a Greek newspaper. He said, there were three bodies, three dead bodies in the bus, and he left the bus within about 10 minutes. So that was his impression. All the bodies were cleared away by this mysterious army depot that was harvesting and collecting all the bodies. The bodies were by noon. They were all taken off to the centre in Hull Street. I don't know if you remember that story. They were given a contract for looking after the bodies on the 6th of July. They got the contract. So they were setting it up, and then they got a special award.
That was the deal. It got given the Olympics. It got given the Olympics on the 6th, London. Yeah. There was that massive high, emotional high, and then the very next day you've got boom.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. But this is the Honourable Artillery Company near Moorgate in East London. Room was set up to receive the dead. Contract received on July 6th, and it's called the De Boer project manager. He got rewarded by meeting Tony Blair at Downing Street for such excellent work, setting up such short notice, right? I mean, 24 hours and the bodies started coming in. So that's a military company. And they also set up structures at each of the four blast sites, structure and furniture, each of the underground stations affected, and refrigeration factory. Facilities at the site of the bus bombing. So there might have been some refrigeration faculties. I mean, that's about as suspicious as it gets. Now that number goes up to 9. I think the Evening Standard on July 7th was 9 dead. I think 13 was the day after, or by the Friday. 13 was the final canonical number, and that's now the number written up on the side of Tavistock Square, 13, right? 13 dead. And that includes Miriam Hyman, who certainly couldn't possibly have died there. I got in a lot of trouble by ringing up the father of Miriam Hyman and asking his story. And everybody was aghast, was shocked that I'd done such a thing. Oh no, you didn't contact one of the victim families, did you? To write my book, I contacted everybody I possibly could, okay? I needed to interact with everybody. And that was one lady who couldn't possibly be on that bus. But I won't go into that. Okay, well, let's just, you asked me to give some details about the Tavistock Square event. Yeah, it's about all I've done, right? Most of the real police were out of London. They were up at the GA summit, okay? And that's presumably why MFI lowered the threat assessment in the weeks before 7/7, right? They lowered it. So that's enabled to get the real police out of London, and the Metropolitan Police mainly up at the GA summit. So they didn't want real bobbies swimming around. And instead they had, what was the police called? Anyway, it's a local police service just around Tavistock Square that were dealing with the event. Metropolitan, I can't remember. Yeah. So it was a very, very theatrical event at Tavistock Square. It got everyone sort of psychologically attuned to it. And obviously featured in that Halevi article in the Jerusalem Post, 2:00. He talked about that site being not far from where the dreams of Zion were initially formulated.
So the bottom of something?
The plan for Israel to be formed was hatched beginning of the 20th century, not far from that Tavistock Square. So what was the building called? Anyway, it's just Great Russell Square, where the British Museum is. So he talked about that being part, well, he felt that was part of the plot. That's the Jerusalem Post view on the top. Yeah.
Given all that we know then now, how the these plots, what are your thoughts on, because they've got to get the terror and like put the slide up of them on the roller coaster,
yeah,
and to heighten awareness of terror,
yeah.
What are your thoughts on what on the next plot? What's the next plot going to be?
Oh, I don't know. I haven't got a crystal ball. Ian Crane thinks there's going to be some fake. Ian Crane is your best futurologist in this country. Right, I recommend you go to one of his talks I don't have a crystal ball.
You've done a lot of research yourself. Just your point of view.
I think that what things are looking like now is Fukushima and the Norway Breivik events. I think those are both fabricated terror.
Yeah.
It's very horrific. Surely have to have some kind of Israeli involvement. I think things will continue to go on and get worse until we get some sort of intelligent media response and commentary. About the only outlet of media in this country that would talk about this kind of thing, more or less, is Press TV. They've just been banned.
Yeah.
You wouldn't get it on Russia TV today. I don't think they've got that far. But we just don't have any media in this country that would even consider this angle. Ian Crane's thing is that there's some sort of Star Wars thing of war against space aliens or something that might happen next year or might.
Can I just point out that G4S, the Israeli security company, are security for the Olympics next year?
Oh, right. What was it called?
G4S.
G4S.
Group 4 as well.
Group 4. They've just been bought out by a bigger company, haven't they? ISS, something they call it.
They've just bought ISS.
That's the Israeli company, is that right? Yeah.
The Israeli company.
I wouldn't be accepting any tickets for the Olympics next year.
They just started reading gas and electric meters as well.
Well, I can't resist quoting Ian here. Talking about Fukushima, how Israeli security company took over that reactor shortly before it blew up. He said anyone employing Israeli security company has really got some questions to answer.
Well, they own AT&T in America as well. The biggest phone system in America is basically an Israeli intelligence operation.
What is that called?
AT&T.
What is doing this? Likes playing funny number games.
Absolutely.
One thing came out of the inquest, let me tell you this. The first bomb went off at Allgate at 11 minutes to 9, okay? Now the inquest, they said, oh, we've got really exact time. We've got atomic time. And this enables us to give the time to the exact second. And it was 8:49:00 seconds. So it was 11 minutes to 9 to within a second. But that is the inquest. Judgment. And so one group of people said, "Oh, well, this shows some funny conspiracy theory going on in the inquest." And I said, no. People running this inquest are not into any playing any funny game like that. They're just reporting it simply what happened. And so that, you know, whatever your experiment meant, inbuilt into the event is that split second accuracy of 9/11 as the foot when the first bomb goes off. You know, maybe that's part of the story, just as you've got 9/11 days in between Madrid and 9/11. Then there's another more funny business. You might go more into the numbers business, which may not be a good idea. But the number 52, which is the number of cards in the deck, 52 was revealed as the number who died much too early. Okay? The Australian front.
Much too early.
The Australian Prime Minister blurted it out the next day, the 8th of July. He said, terrible, and 52 dead. And they couldn't possibly know it then. And then about a week later, about on the 11th, so I can't remember the exact date, somewhere around maybe the 12th or so, they came out with this 52 total, when two of the people who were finally in the total hadn't yet died. They were still in hospital, between life and death. So, you shouldn't have arrived at the number of 52 until something like 2 weeks after the event, when those people had really finally died. So you're wondering how the counting is going on. How exactly the counting is going on.
Have they been encouraged to die then?
Well, just let me finish. It's talking about funny number games. If you want to remember the numbers, you've got 13. That's the number in one pack of one suit of cards. At Tavison Square, you got twice 13, that's 26, in the Piccadilly line one, and then the last 13 is divided 6 and 7 in two of the Edgware Road and Aldgate. So it's as if the number games are somehow being played out there in a funny way. Yeah?
Yeah, are they being encouraged to die or bumped off if they want to get this magical number to tie in with?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, the Norway massacre, a total of 77 died. You know, it seems quite a significant number.
Well, that kept getting revised downwards.
Kept getting revised downwards. Yeah. Ended up at 77. But probably, I don't recommend getting too much into the numerology side of it. And especially don't try and predict events from numerology, which we sometimes try to do. Yeah.
You're sort of hinting at it, though, aren't you? I mean, I know you've got to stay fairly grounded.
But it is Cabalism.
You do see the Cabalism involved, and you are seeing the fingerprints of Mossad.
So
where's this pointing to then?
Well, I honestly don't know.
You're my friends.
All my book says is, I talk about the axis of evil, and I talk that about being CIA, Mossad, MI6, that you can't really separate them. That's as far as I can go. I mean, I don't believe MI5 would have done this by themselves.
Well, they always subcontract. Every intelligence agency always subcontracts to other people.
Yeah, in a sense, the determining event that made this happen was Bush and Blair meeting at Gleneagles at the GO summit, okay? And if you want to be conspiratorial, you can say the day before they were deciding who was going to get the Olympics, given that France had already halfway building it in Paris. France was totally confident they were going to get the Olympics, right? So maybe in some bohemian grove there was some deal. Okay, look, Tony Blair said, look, okay, look, we'll do this event in return for getting the Olympics. If you want to have that conjecture, the decision of that. So it was Bush and Blair meeting together that meant this event had to happen. And it had to happen very quickly at the beginning of the Gleneagles summit. Vast billions of pounds are involved. Do you understand why that was?
No.
because enormous musical thing make poverty history. The enormous worldwide campaign, terrific free concerts. Think about terrific euphoria. Can you remember it?
Yeah.
You remember it? The euphoria. How often the British people admit of euphoria? And it was forgive the debt of Africa. Forgive the debt of Africa. That was the message, wasn't it? Do you remember all that? Okay. Now, how could the huge multinationals, they're getting all the gold and diamonds and stuff out of Africa, and they're told to forgive the debt? You know, so that the big multinationals who really control our world would have had to pull out of Africa in a big way due to popular demand. And 7-7 was to stop that happening. If 7-7 hadn't happened, the G8 summit would have been under almost irresistible pressure to really do something about forgiving the debt of Africa. Okay? That would have had to happen, I suggest. And 7-7 prevented that. Instead, the whole narrative became Bush and Blair walking tall against terror.
So it's almost a little bit like the same sort of thing that happened on the 8th of, or no, the 10th of September 2001, when Rumsfeld disclosed the 2.3 trillion.
Oh, yeah.
Then the very next day, it's all out the window. So it's the same sort of scenario, what we're talking about, giving the debt, the very next day, it's out the window.
Oh, right, yeah, okay.
Nick, the families of the victims,
families
of the deceased,
yeah.
Have they any notion of what they believe has happened?
Well, all we know is...
they all believe the government narrative on this.
Well,
we know.
Do we? I'm not showing that. We're always told that the families, anyone who really experienced it, believes the government narrative. That's the crap that Rachel North always comes out with. Oh, you know, if you really experience this terror, then you don't believe this ridiculous conspiracy nonsense. But that's the crap they come out with. All I can tell you is that the families are incredibly pissed off by what happened to them at the inquest. I mean, the whole point of an inquest is to ascertain the cause of death. That is supposedly the point of an inquest, right? And you've got a 5-month inquest, okay? And were the families told any? I mean, the families were told no post-mortems were performed. No post-mortems. Hang on, what's going on here? 52 dead, worst attack on London since the Blitz, no post-mortems. Well, what did they do then? They go to this De Boer military company, took off the bodies, what did they do? Sell them for body parts? Or what? How can you have... So, and then...
Did the families not get the bodies back then?
Well, that's a very good question. Glad you asked. The families... First of all, there's a delay of about a week when these people had total ID on them and should have been recognised right away. Families are kept waiting for ages, a week or 10 days, and they were not encouraged to see the bodies. Or their accounts... I think I managed to get 5 or 6 testimonies of whether... It's an extremely important question you just asked, which is hard to answer, and whether they got the bodies back or not. I think when they did get them back, they were sort of embalmed and made up, and a sufficiently long time had gone by that you wouldn't want to start doing surgical operations to find if someone had, I don't know, taken their heart out or whatever, and sold their lungs or whatever. I think it's very peculiar that the victim families had to wait, generally, a week or 10 days, if they got them back at all. And there's accounts of this stone warning of bureaucracy that they find that they're heartbroken and shattered, and they get this stone warning bureaucracy. And there's people who have written books about this. And if only we could get through to those families, I think that'll be a terrific catalyst for change. If only you know any possible way of getting through to them. Because they're the people who've got the power in this story. They may not realise it, but they are holding the power. One of them wanted to step out and say something, the media would really, really listen to them.
Can I echo that? Because yesterday, instead of being with Nick in London, I was actually in Westminster in the House of Commons at the Hillsborough debate on disclosure. And I witnessed something quite extraordinary there, the power of the families and the support behind the families.
Right.
Even though it's taken 22 years, you had a debate in the Commons that the like of which I don't think has been seen before, Now, they're not my words, they're the words of the likes of MP Frank Field and quite a few others who gave speeches yesterday. And I did sense that it, you know, and this is, you know, the villains of the piece here are my old police force, South Yorkshire Police,
right,
to a large extent on Hillsborough, that in as much as they have kept things under wrapped on that. But yeah, you can see the power of the families that eventually they've exerted through petitioning and just persevering.
Yeah.
Now, our difficulty with finding the truth on 7/7 is unless we can get the families to recognise the fact that the government narrative is unacceptable and that there's a far more plausible story, we're always going to be fighting an uphill struggle. So we may have to start to think cleverly, you know, about strategy.
Just add to what Tony showed. You might think there's some nice, happy 7/7 research group in London, but there isn't, okay? There's sort of bitterness and infighting of different groups. And when Mohammed, after he came out of jail, there's quite a sort of strong feeling, you know, put him in jail for making his film and stuff. And with Tony being there, first time ever, we had a sense of a group of us that really liked being together and could work together. With Mohammed, he's got long, looks like some Bible character, his long white beard, you know, and his staff. I think him and Tony got an initiative of wanting to do things. And if Mohammed had stayed around London, I think that's the kind of thing that we might have been able to do, of identifying the people we want to try and contact. And I think Mohammed's got quite a gentle way of being able to approach people. That could have anyway, he's gone off to Ireland now. He says he'll come back, but I haven't been. But
he was in Blackpool doing the same presentation, similar presentation as you yesterday.
Was it?
Yeah.
All right.
I haven't seen
him,
so.
Oh, right.
Is that to say you think there's no mechanism for informing these people about, look, we're here and we understand the situation? You don't think there's a mechanism for problem?
Well, like I said, personally, it's a bit like trying to contact any of the families. I mean, I can tell you something I'd really, really like to talk to, apart from families, is Omar Khayyam, a chap in the Crevice case. He was a fanatical cricketer, and he was framed for old case. And he knew Khan. It's picture him talking to Khan. So, you know, if we could talk to him about how did you know Khan, that would be. And then I think the best person of all would be Hasina Patel, who's in Sheffield. She's remarried. She's not called Patel anymore. If anyone could find her and get a story of her, that would be totally central if we could do that. The Egyptian guy probably isn't alive anymore, Magdi Al-Nashar. He got a doctorate from Leeds University in chemistry. Was it biochemistry? He was renting 18 Alexandra Grove. And he was friends with Hasib Hussain. There's no evidence any of them actually came to his flat, but he left 18 Alexandra Grove 2 days before 7/7, about the 5th. He flew up to Cairo because the purpose was to thank the various bodies and organisations that funded his PhD. Okay? And he had a return ticket, come back on the 12th of August. Well, he never did come back. He was put in jail in Cairo. And they just tell you this, the British authorities arrested him, got him arrested, and they confiscated his laptop. Okay? And they found his laptop was full of classical music, that's all it had on it. So it didn't have Al Qaeda addresses or on making recipes, you know, it's just classical music. Anyway, he was the only person that the British government managed to arrest for the 7/7 crime, and they had to let him off. But now, they obviously cannot allow him to reappear. They cannot. Why not? Because they put all these, planted all this massive stuff in 18 Alexandra Grove, you know, all ridiculous bits of junk in the bath. And the Sun newspaper, that's actually another source, showed pictures of the bath with some brownish junk in it, alleged to be bomb-making stuff left behind. And it looks as if some coke-snorting drug dealers have been in there for a week or so. Left the place a right mess. I could just mention that the initial reports of the 18 Alexandra Grove came over from America, and we had a simulation of the 18 Alexandra Grove being built somewhere in America. Well, that's it. and had a huge fridge in it, a huge industrial fridge. That was one of the first bits of information we had about Asian American Girl. Because if you remember, the story was TATP, and that needed to be kept cooled. Well, it needed cooled, then you've got to have a big fridge, haven't you? So, unfortunately, a new lot of storytellers that came along by the time of the inquest, they omitted the big fridge. Somehow this reported fact about Asian American Girl vanished by the time the photos that were released to the British media of 1890 Summer Grove. Anyway, it's clear that when all that had been done, Magdi al-Nashar cannot possibly, well, I doubt if he's still alive, but if he is dead, we really, really want to know if he's dead, actually. This is the sort of thing where, if anyone could help, is someone in Cairo, family of al-Nashar, is he still alive? Has he been lent on that he will never speak to anyone again? I mean, this is quite an important fact. A graduate of Leeds University suddenly gets his name blackened. Preposterous stories woven about his I couldn't imagine him being allowed to comment about £20 of TATP left in his bath. I mean, imagine if he was allowed to comment on that as a chemist. I mean, it would make a laughing stock of the British government. So he cannot be allowed to. A lot of most key people cannot be allowed to speak. And the question is, what happened to them?
What do you think John Charles de Menezes had to do with it?
Well, we've already, haven't we already been asked that?
Not directly, how he was linked with the.
Yeah, I mean, people conjecture that some electrical seals might be involved, but there's no evidence of any connection. You just don't know what it was he was supposed to have done wrong, why they picked him.
Is it just no smoke and bullshit to take his eye away from what's really going on?
It could be, yeah. It could be they wanted a distraction after 21-7. They arrested these four guys who, with their Japati flour and peroxide in the back of their rucksack. See, those four on 21-7 really did make mixed Japati flour and hydrogen peroxide in their flour, okay? And they really did mess about trying to distill it. If you buy hair shampoo or something, a hair bleach with peroxide in, and you put it in a saucepan and boil it up, it won't concentrate, it really won't, you know. You really won't end up with anything that will go bang.
Yeah, I mean, real terrorism is always cat handy. That's all the proof you need. Something as precision as 7-7 or 9-11, it's just got to have been planned well in advance.
Yeah, but there's quite a lot of, apparently, there's quite a lot of hydrogen peroxide stories which are completely bogus chemistry. I mean, the 21-7, a sort of green slime dribbled out of the back of the rucksack onto the floor of the coach, and MSK, anyway, he made a joke, so it's only bread. It's a peroxide chapati flour. The main injury suffered on 21-7 was a bystander had an asthma attack. Okay, that was all, and they got about 40 years for that. As well as, you know, they're in for life. About five of them, and also various relatives of people. Loads were put into jail on that 21-7 thing. Poor. And then, on the analogy of the chapati flour peroxide, the black pepper peroxide then kind of somehow blossomed in a demented kind of way.
Yeah. I'm sorry to ask slightly away from this, but just wondering, you said something right at the beginning that I didn't quite understand about Mohammed Sidique Khan when he went to Pakistan.
Yeah.
You mentioned that he might have. I thought
the last visit, I think he might have visited, might have something about visiting one of his camps. And Wahid Ali, I was at this trial of his in the summer of 2008.
This is one of the three friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he went on this. He emphasised that it was regarded as totally ethical, Muslim ethics, and it was defending the integrity of a Muslim country. I think it was based in Kashmir, I was a member. And he said that form of, I don't know if you call it jihad, that the point of these training camps was, it's a bit like a British going to some army training camp, It was regarded as totally ethical, and the local Muslim community raised funds for it so they could go over. And he said that has got nothing whatever to do with terrorism. So it was a totally opposite thing. It did involve practice shooting rifles, and they never killed anyone or shot anyone, but they were practicing in those camps, and it was regarded as a virtuous thing to do.
So it was more geared towards the Kashmir situation than anything?
I think so. I mean, personally, I'd like to hear debates in Leeds, Beeston about the ethics of this and what was going on. But certainly at that trial, 2008, it was regarded as ethical, and I think that Waheed Ali seemed to indicate that he thought Khan had spent some time at one of those camps. Though he didn't, he said he hardly saw him. So it started up, whether he did that or whether he just went to visit an uncle. I mean, really, if we could get some testimony from people in Pakistan who knew these lads, it would be enormously helpful.
When was this? This was...
In 2008, what was the so-called July 7th trial, when Waheed Ali was testifying.
When
he went out in November 2004, and he came back, I think, February 2005.
Did any of the terrorists, in inverted commas, give reasons to friends or family as to why they were going down to London?
Hasib Hussain told his mother to go up to London. His mother just said something about how he loved going there, and he liked the big eye and the aquarium, and he had a big thrill for him to go up to London. And something about the last they saw of him was about noon or 3 o'clock on the 6th. So people wondered if he'd actually gone the night before. And then she rings up the police at 10 o'clock on the 7th, worried that he hasn't come back yet. Which seems very early to me to phone the police if he's been all the way to London. But that's apparently what she did.
Was the news was out by then, presumably, so she might have been worried that her son had been caught in the bomb?
Might have been, yeah. But I can't think of any other testimony of what it went for now.